Raj, I'm so happy to be here at the university where you've brought in so many changes. I'm really looking forward to this chat with you for Project Bolo. Raj, when and where were you born? Where was your schooling?
I was born in Bombay, South Bombay actually. I went to St. Xavier's High School. I went to a Commerce College, HR College, and graduated with Commerce. But then I quickly sort of changed my line and did an MA and a PhD in Literature. I did all my education up to the doctoral degree in Bombay, University of Bombay. Nissim Ezekiel was one of my professors, and I went on to write his biography, which was published in 2000. It's only after my doctoral studies that I went to England for the first time. I was 35, and that was my first trip abroad. This has a bearing on some of the things that we might talk about later on, because it is in England that my perceptions to queer-related issues changed. Until then, it was just a sexual preference, a sexual need, sexual hunger, and I would do anything to, you know, to satisfy that hunger. But there was no notion of identity or orientation or anything like that.
When did you first realize about your sexuality?
I knew pretty early, you know. I think that when I was 13 years, there was one sexual encounter I had with a girl who was a neighbor in the same building. But other than that, it was entirely men, young men, not even men, I would say boys I was attracted to. And so I knew it pretty early. I may have been a little anxious about it. I may have been a little anxious about the fact that when I get to marriageable age, you know, what do I do and so on. But I'm quite sort of amazed by a lot of people who say that, oh, they don't know what their sexuality is. And I suspect that people lie when they say such things, because I think that everybody knows what their sexuality is and sexual orientation is. And I knew pretty early during my teenage.
What were the gay spaces during those days?
I don't think there were any spaces. I think that there were cruising places which you quickly learnt about, the washrooms and the Maidans after dark. In South Bombay, the Oval Maidan was famous, but I discovered another Maidan, not as high profile as the Oval Maidan, which was the Azad Maidan, bang opposite where I lived and was born and grew up. So I would go there, come evening, and I would just sort of, there was an urgency, almost driven, you know, and I would head there. And there were the railway station toilets, there were the crowded local trains. I've cashed in quite heavily on this in different works, you know.
Raj, why do you think gay men have this urgency to have sex in public spaces?
But I think the explanation for that has been given time and again, and that is that it tends to be a here and now thing. You can never be certain. It's like, to give you an analogy, you know, someone who can't be sure of the next meal will grab whatever he gets.
But it may be disturbing to others?
As I said, political correctness and moral correctness are different ball games altogether. And this is the thing, that I approach all of these things as a literary artist. So I can't, I simply can't endorse political correctness. It would make my narrative extremely boring.
When did you start writing?
I had started writing for magazines myself by that point, for the Youth Times and for some of the Times of India, other publications. But none of these things were on gay issues. They were not fictions yet. They were features. But again, if one analyzes them, you know, I used to do these profiles, and I remember I did one with an ODP restaurant waiter, because bang opposite my house, opposite the Liberty Theatre, there is a well-known ODP restaurant. And I was quite sort of enamored by this waiter. And I did this profile. So sure, there is a sexual angle there, which was not manifest in the piece itself and the photographs that the magazine sent their photographer to take pictures and so on. But there was certainly a subtext to this. So, you know, this is how it began. But my first full-fledged gay short story appeared in another magazine called Debonair. And the year was 1985. This was before I went to England. And I risked writing it. And some literary friends of mine, you know, when it appeared, they asked me if I were not scared, you know, because I think the story was in the first person. It was called Confessions of a Boy Lover. And I had heavily drawn on a relationship. That was, in fact, my first serious relationship that had happened a few years ago and which sort of blew up in my face. Actually, my latest novel, Hostel Room 131, goes back to that whole period of my life.
Do writers draw from their own life experiences?
I think most writers are, you know, we rely heavily on life. I mean, the imagination comes in at a later stage, but there's not something that you can concoct entirely from the imagination. So you need some kind of raw material. So the relationships have always provided me with the raw material, because as you will might find out later, and I've said this elsewhere too, that there comes a stage when you live your life in such a way that it automatically will provide the raw material for your next book or next film in your case. So all my relationships have been like that. They've not been, they're not just queer, but they are unconventional even from a queer perspective.
Raj, you said your identity was politicized by your stay in UK. In what sense?
It's about the fact that queerness is more than just a sexual preference, that that it entails issues that need to be discussed, thrashed, sorted out, brainstormed. These were things I learned that, you know, it was serious business. Before I went to the UK, I wouldn't have thought of it in that way. It could be something that you wrote about, so it did serve an artistic purpose, but not so much an intellectual purpose. So this is what I picked up at Warwick. And I also saw that, you know, there were things like the gay and lesbian society existed in almost every university campus. And there were gay bars and, you know, places where people hung out in the evening. So it shaped my my thoughts. It's what made me radical. At that point, my definition of radical might have been slightly different from what it is now, because we're talking about, what, 20 years ago. At that point, being an activist, you know, talking about issues concerning sexuality seemed radical to me.
Did it also shape your writings?
A little while after I got back, not immediately after I came back, but a few years later, Riyadh made Bomb Gay based on my poems. So I was writing those poems from the time I came back, from the time I got back. The year was 1991. The Bomb Gay finally came out in 1996, so there was a 5-year gap. But when Bomb Gay came out, of course, it was completely in the press and everywhere. It must have been something of a tightrope walk, because there was my family to think about. My father had passed away by then, but there was my mom and my sister who are still there, in the same flat in Bombay, and I visit them at least once a month. And then there were my college jobs. I worked in different colleges before I joined the Department of English at Pune University. I worked at KC College, SIES College, RD National College in Bandra.
Was it difficult to get a job in college because you are gay?
No, that's what I'm saying, that I think I very skillfully kept the two things separate. So that at college, at the workplace, during classes, the issue never came up. I think what aided me was that I can pass off for straight. I think that makes a big difference, because if you take someone like Hoshan, I think that's what gives him, has always given him away. And it has made life very hard for him. So I think that I was, I shouldn't use the word lucky, but it was something that I could cash in on, that I could pass off as straight.
You also wrote a book, One Day I Locked My Flat in Seoul City. When was that?
That came out a year before Bombay was made. It came out in 1995. It was the first edition which did not have as many stories as the second edition in 2001. But it still had this debonair story, and it had a few other stories. So this was a year before Bombay. And again, yes, the reviews were uniformly good. And most of the reviews were by fellow writers, which is not what happens now. Now suddenly, you know, I mean, the activists have got hold of my work. And it's also, it also shows how editors of books and magazines have sort of lost their mind, because the moment they think it's a gay novel or they see my name, they would send it to the activists who know nothing about writing. But with the first book, it was not like that. It was reviewed by Vilas Sarang, it was reviewed by Gauri Deshpande, by Vijay Nambisan, by Bulbul Sharma, and I got very good reviews. The fact that I was my themes were queer was no big deal, in that all writing has to have some theme, and mine had queerness. So it was wonderful. You know, I really liked that period, because there were no issues.
Raj, did you have any difficulty finding publishers for your work?
Mainstream publishers, I think they want a good work. Maybe in 1999, when Penguin published Hoshang's anthology of gay writing, Yarana, I don't know whether they had some reservations. I've never discussed it with Penguin directly, but Hoshang, I think, said at that point. Now they brought out an enlarged edition of Yarana. It's called Gay Writing from South Asia, but maybe at that time, and there was also Facing the Mirror, the lesbian anthology. But I suspect that publishers want a good work, something that works from their point of view as fiction or poetry or whatever.
During this time, were you in Bombay or Pune?
I was in Pune. When I went to England, I was already here. I came here in 1988, I went to England in 1990, returned in 91. From 1996 onwards, I was writing a biography, Nisim Izikul's biography. The storyline for Boyfriend was germinating at that point. But I started writing it only after 2000. So, and then it came out in 2003. So I think that it took about 2 years in the writing.
Was it a product of another relationship?
Absolutely. I think that's quite well known, that I met this boy who was 19 and Dalit at the Churchgate Loo. I was a great one for washroom sex. And I still would swear by it. I think the internet is no match, because washroom sex is extremely sensuous, and internet sex doesn't have half of that sensuality. This is where I met Rakesh, and we took it from there. And the fact that something that begins in so sordid a way can blossom into a serious relationship, I think, is quite amazing, which I think needs to be recorded. And I think that the book does it.
What kind of person do you get attracted to?
The working man has always been my hero. I don't know where that comes from. It could come from my early romance with Marxism or what, I don't know. But the working man, and also that the younger working man. So, and I've not had problems finding the kind of people I want and having serious, you know, it's not so, people say this is, I have all my friends, there's a big sort of chasm, because intellectually all my friends are either, they're professionals, they're academics, both gay and straight. But when it comes to my love life, you know, then it's a very different kind of guy that I'm looking for.
And what about the image of gay men? Do you see a change?
The thing is to shun stereotypes, and if you detect a stereotype, I think that one should try and move away from it. But having said that, I think that it's best left to the individual. Stereotyping is the silliest thing to do, the stupidest thing to do, because anybody could be a gay man or a homosexual, you know, or someone with a homosexual side. And I think that that's what the word queer does, you know, it would include all these people under the ambit of queer. Also that when you talk about the stereotyping and all that, again we are, I guess, talking about a certain segment of society that is affluent and so on. But what about those who are outside the pale of affluent society and are also queer?
Okay, going back to your writing, who has been your inspiration?
The great masters of fiction in the 20th century, Joyce, Foster, Orwell. I mean, these were great influences, and I think that judicious reviewers have always been able to trace these influences. Swift, who lived at an earlier point in history, you know, the whole business of satire and his whole analogy of distortion, looking at yourself in not a plane mirror but a convex and a concave mirror. And I have a poem called Self-Portrait where I do this. From Oscar Wilde and from people like that, you get this whole theory of narcissism. So yes, there were influences and all that. There was all that aspect which went into the craft and the technique. But for the basic storyline, I said, you know, my own life is quite dramatic, which it was and which it continues to be. And I don't have to look elsewhere.
Also, I think there's a certain starkness in your writing.
I think that would tie in with the whole anti-establishment stance and you know, his business of taking panga with society, and you know, people like art painters like Van Gogh and all that were people who inspired me a lot, because this was also much earlier in my during my teen years. You know, the whole dumb maro dumb syndrome. You know,
what has been your family's reaction?
My family has been extremely supportive and so on, but still there's the residues of conservatism in them even now. If you went to my mom and sister and talked to them, they would say, well, we're not too comfortable talking about this, but that doesn't mean that we don't love each other. There's a deep and abiding love.
Has your mother read your books?
I must tell you that I call my mother every day, and yesterday after I got here I called her, and you know, she was saying that she started reading Hostel Room 131 and she felt very pained. In fact, it worried me because she is now over 82, and you know, I don't want her to have any emotional trauma or anything at this age. But you know, I had to rub it in that this is fiction, but I couldn't fool her too much. And she said, the thing she said was that what pains her is the most at this point is that she couldn't come to my aid at that point. She never even knew that I was going through all this. So that was extremely touching.
Raj, how different or similar is Boyfriend from your next book, Hostel Room 131?
No, they are different novels. I mean, they're different stories. They do have some elements in common. For example, the parental generation is the enemy in both cases. The socioeconomic backgrounds of the lovers might be different in both cases. But then, other than that, they're moving in different directions. And they're also told very differently, in that I think Boyfriend follows a structure that's more or less chronological, whereas with Hostel Room 131, I think the narrative technique is a little more complex, in that it begins at the present and it's told in the present tense and the first person, and then later part of it is told in the third person and uses the past tense. So those are things that matter to me as a writer.
Also, Hostel Room 131 is set earlier.
Boyfriend comes later. Boyfriend is set in the 90s. There's a reference to the demolition of the Babri Masjid and so on. So it begins around 92 and finishes after 5 or 6 years, or maybe by the turn of the century. Whereas Hostel Room 131 is dealing with the late 70s and early 80s. And that is why when Ashok said in a review in Hindustan Times that the gay party, there's a gay party scene, there's a gay orgy scene, and he says that these are old hat. And I was very angry because I said that he's overlooking the fact that I'm writing about the late 70s and early 80s, not about now, you know.
Are gay relationships or the gay scene any different now?
You know, this brings us to deeper and more serious issues of class and so on. I think that when you say contemporary India, we are talking about an educated English-speaking class for whom things may have changed. So I think that your formulation of contemporary India is a bit misleading, because it's only one side of contemporary India. The taxi driver, the auto driver, the masseur, the Udipi restaurant waiter, the motor mechanic, they're also a part of contemporary India for whom things might not have substantially changed. So what about that, and who is to sort of record? Are we saying that that segment of society doesn't count? I have a feeling that when you say contemporary, this is what I would call queer fundamentalism, that we have no tolerance for those who don't want to come out of the closet, who can't be open about their sexuality, who can't speak in terms of gay rights. We just sort of exclude them. They don't count and they don't matter.
Apart from writing, Raj, you founded a queer literary group here, right?
There's an issue of Trikon, which Sandeep Roy brought out from San Francisco, which actually chronicles the whole history of Queer Studies Circle, which I started here as a sort of underground organization in the late 90s with some students of mine. We met here in this very office, initially once every fortnight, but then it became less frequent, the meetings. A lot of people came from within the university, from Pune City, from elsewhere. People got to know of us. We had discussions. It was basically a discussion group. My idea was, to get people to acquaint each other with their personal histories, not sort of censor their own stories, but to feel free to talk about them, and so that we could put them together. So this was my idea.
You have now started a queer study course in the university.
When I started this lesbian and gay literature course in the department, it's now been running for 3 years, and believe me, it's oversubscribed. Out of 60 students in the department, last year I had 44 who opted for the course. And I think that this in itself would justify the running of such a course.
Do you see changes in the queer writing space?
I think we need to understand that the whole movement, the whole business of being open about your sexuality is a nascent movement in this country, and it would take a while. Do know that there are younger people who have been writing in the regional languages as well. In Marathi, of course, there are a couple of books that have been published, Bindu's and Chetan Dathar's play and so on, but I'm sure that in other languages too, in Kannada, in Tamil, in a few North Indian languages. So all of it might not get published, or even if it's published, it might not be distributed in a way that we get to know about it. But it's not as if it's not there.
Would a queer publishing initiative help?
Yeah, but you know, I'm not very happy with my work. It's okay, my work is there, provided it's also at in other forums and other venues. Otherwise, this has been my lament over time, that I have allowed the queer community to appropriate me. And I've had to pay a price for that, because then you cease to be a part of mainstream literature. Of course, you might say, what is mainstream literature?
Raj, are you in a relationship right now?
Sandeep. I met him 4 years ago, or 5 years ago. He's 23, but it's worked very well. I keep saying he can do, you'll see later on, you know, the lights and everything is all done by him. And yesterday he cooked a wonderful meal. Now, a lot of people can't do these things. He's brilliant with his hands. If my tire is punctured, he changes it. So this is what Robinson Crusoe called his Man Friday. And my boyfriends have always been that. But then, in turn, you know, I mean, they're certainly getting something from me. So it works very well. And actually, if you ask me, a lot of queer relationships work this way. It's just that people are very guarded about these things. They don't want to speak about them. There's this whole thing now in the West about gay shame as opposed to gay pride, you know. And that's again coming from a platform of, you know, of fighting back and resisting and being anti-establishment and being left-wing and being anti and not being pro. Whereas gay pride would typify a sort of conformism. So I'm on the side of these things, whether it comes to writing or relationships or friendships or...
Does it make it difficult for people? So does it make it difficult for people to like you?
I would say that, yes. Except for a small circle of close friends I have who'd swear by me, but otherwise I'm certainly not a popular person. And what you get is the kind of politeness. I know that people are bitching about me in the university, elsewhere, in the neighborhood. But they don't, the nice thing, the okay thing is that they wouldn't do it to my face. But you know that it's there, and you just sort of leave it at that. But it doesn't bother me. Actually, I'm quite happy with the way I've ordered my life in terms of my lifestyle. Apart from the writing, I'm very proud of the writing I've done. Also, it's not got me big awards or anything. I'll never get a Saitya Academy Award. I'm not invited to the Jaipur Literary Festival or, you know, big things like that. But I'm still very proud of my writing. And then I'm quite happy about the way I've lived my life.
Has your mother never sat you down and asked you about your life?
No, she did not. And also that she is unwilling to read my books, because she says, her argument is that it would hurt me, it would pain me. So it's not homophobia. Though some might say that at the end of the day it still amounts to homophobia. But it's a mother in her, you know. And now that I have an adopted son who's 15, I can see it from her point of view.
Ah, I didn't know you had an adopted son. When did you adopt him?
He's actually the son of one of my boyfriends with whom I had a very serious relationship. After the first one blew up in my face, this was about 7 years later. And this one also in a way blew up in my face because he got married soon after, and I was in England at the time and he didn't tell me, and when I came back it was a big setback. But then after 5 years he had this son, and he made me see that marriage in India, especially from the startup society from which he came, was not an option. And when the son was born, he came to me and said that he's not English speaking and not college educated, but he would like his son to be, so could I help? And you know, being in the teaching field, you know, it was not difficult to get him into an English medium school. But that was the beginning, because then I had to sort of talk to him in English. And so this is how I became a sort of de facto parent. But it was not just, official, or I mean a technical thing. It was love that I started to feel. The same love that I felt for Rajendra, I started to feel for his son Rahul.
Being a father, has it changed you in any way?
I think it changes you a lot. I think that part of the rebellion and the anti-establishment stance goes away. I'm not too happy about that. You tend to become a little conformist. When he was much younger, you know, I would sit with him and take up his lessons, and that meant not leading my kind of lifestyle. You know, I had to spend a long time with him. I couldn't, I'm quite a wanderer and stuff like that. So all that had to take a back seat. I also have lived a fairly promiscuous life. So all that had to be put on the back burner for a bit. Now it's a little different because he himself is, you know, he doesn't want me sort of breathing down his throat. But yes, I think you become a bit of a family man. And a lot of other gay people who don't have, you know, I find myself saying to my other gay friends, no, Baba, I'm a baal bachche wala. And then I say, God, you know, what have I done to myself? But no, I'm pretty happy.
Raj, you have left me speechless. This is so different from the Raj I thought I knew. Thank you so much for sharing your story with Project Bolo.